Everyone, welcome to the 9th Mama Charitable Foundation Visiting Professor in Buddhist Studies lecture series. The theme of the series this year is A Monkey Jumps and Britain Awakens to Mahayana, Aspects of the Westward Spread of Chinese Buddhism. Today is the second lecture of the series, and we're very happy and honored to have invited Professor T.H. Barrett again to share with us his insight and wisdom. The topic for today's lecture is In the Service of Empire, Chinese Buddhism in British Academic Life. Before the lecture begins, I'd like to invite Dr. Pu from the Hong Kong Youth Center of Buddhist Studies to introduce Professor Barrett. Dr. Pu, please.
All right. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the second lecture of the 9th Mama Charitable Foundation Lecture Series in Buddhist Studies, given by the distinguished scholar, Professor Tim Barrett, who is now Professor Emeritus of SOAS, the University of London, and who also happened to be my PhD supervisor many years ago. I'm Chen Zhongpu, a member of the Center for the Buddha Study at the University of London, Hong Kong. And it is my great honor to introduce tonight's speaker. Well, technically, just say a few words before the lecture. I don't really think the professor needs one introduction, not only because he is well known in the research field of the history of East Asian religions, particularly Taoism, but also because our director, Professor Guangxin, in the last lecture has already done so. So last time the professor talked about how animal stories served as interesting elements in the cultural contact between China and Europe. Tonight's the professor's lecture is going to move, narrow down from Europe to Britain, the Imperial Britain. So without further ado, let's enjoy the professor's talk. Over to you, Professor.
Thank you very much, Chandal. And thanks to everybody for coming back to another lecture in this series, in which I'm looking at the spread of an awareness of Chinese Buddhism in Europe and primarily, as has just been said, the British Isles, from a number of different perspectives. Now, last week, I went back to the very earliest contacts in medieval times and tried to bring out some of the complex background to the telling of animal stories to visitors from another culture. Some of you may have felt that this was just all too much monkey business. And I will readily admit that ever since childhood trips to the zoo, I've long been impressed by monkeys and particularly impressed by the elegance of gibbons. So perhaps I was a little self-indulgent. But these days, sooner or later, as we grow up, we are very likely to meet someone brought up in another culture. And then problems of communication come very quickly to the fore, whether we talk about apparently simple topics like animals or attempt to discuss more evidently profound matters. When I was 21, I met a Japanese professor of Anglo-Saxon, but I couldn't speak to him because he didn't speak English. He'd never lived outside Japan and had never had the chance to learn my language. His wife, however, did speak English, and she told me that he found Anglo-Saxon England very interesting, but he found the religion quite unfamiliar and difficult. My own situation, as I pointed out in my last lecture, has been very similar in terms of linguistic limitations. And I, for my part, found the China that existed at the same time as Anglo-Saxon England very interesting. And because I likewise found the religion of that period unfamiliar and difficult to grasp, I took the opportunity when I graduated to learn more about it in America, studying with a man who had himself graduated from a Japanese university. Now, Stanley Weinstein, my teacher, who lived from 1929 to 2017, was an extraordinary scholar in the field of Buddhist studies, who'd actually started his teaching career in London, though he spent most of it at Yale in the USA. In 2018, his Japanese university, Komazawa, invited a group of his students to their campus for a memorial meeting. And it was there that I met a young Chinese scholar who afterwards moved from Japan to London. And he it was who asked me an important question that I tried to answer in a lecture I gave about a year ago, and which I've now slightly revised and extended for you. It involves a consideration of some broad historical issues that I hope will be of some value, even to those who are not particularly interested in studying Buddhism or religion of any sort. And I should tell you right away that he had a follow-up question after considering what I had to say, which was, how about the British study of Tibet? Now, I'm almost completely ignorant when it comes to Tibetan studies, and I know not a word of the Tibetan language. But this time I've tried to add a few words on that topic also on the basis of the work of other researchers. I apologize if this is little more than a cursory addendum to what I had to say last year. But the initial question was quite straightforward. What research was done on Chinese Buddhism in the English academic world before Stanley Weinstein started teaching in London? My questioner had noticed that in the standard history of the study of Buddhism in Europe and America, there were only some mentions of work on China at the ends of chapters, and wondered what the reason for this was. Of course, he was well aware that the standard history that he was using was not comprehensive, and that the relative lack of mention of research from the United Kingdom on Chinese Buddhism might be the outcome of the particular interests of the scholar who compiled it. So if you don't know the work in question, I should offer a few words of explanation about it. The author was a very distinguished Dutch professor who spent much of his career in Australia, J.W. de Jong, who lived from 1921 to 2000. And his book, entitled A Brief History of Buddhist Studies in Europe and America, makes plain the relative limits of his remarks. And I quote from it. The main emphasis has been put on philological studies. From a geographical point of view, India is the principal country dealt with, but developments in the Theravada countries and in China and Tibet have not been entirely neglected. But we need to say a little more. The author was certainly well qualified to compose a broader survey, since he not only read all the major languages of Europe, including Russian, and of course the classic South Asian Buddhist languages of Pali and Sanskrit. He also knew Chinese and Japanese, Tibetan and Mongol. So his little book, when it came out, was also the outcome of a considerable process of expansion from the time of he made his first survey of the topic, which appeared in a Japanese-based journal in 1974. In 1983, a Chinese translation of this first installment of his work was published in Hong Kong by a Huo Taohui. Together with some other materials relating to Professor de Jong, including a very useful bibliography of his publications up to 1980, which already by then had come to a total of 391 works. This little book is a good testament to the study of Buddhism in Hong Kong at that time, and I do commend it to you. From these sources, it is plain to see that Professor de Jong's characterization of his work does indeed reflect the main directions in which his own personal interests lay, as compared with what I'm going to talk about today. So if we wish to understand the pattern of the publications in Britain that should be mentioned to supplement this work, then we must, in my view, being a historian, we must start a long way back, and we must talk not only about the books in question, or even about the scholars that produce them and their own individual preferences, but also about the whole pattern of British imperial history in Asia. This takes us some way back, not as far as the times of William of Rubruck that I mentioned last week, but only until the beginning of the 15th century, which was in fact the date of the disappearance of the last great Welsh leader, Owain Glyndwr. Because it was only after that that the English became the masters even of the southern half of the islands where they live. And for the most of the rest of that century, the 15th century, the land was torn by civil wars until the emergence of a ruler who was perhaps fortunately of partly Welsh descent. So England did not become an effectively centralized kingdom until really the start of the 16th century, at which point it found itself not well placed to compete with threatening continental powers such as France and Spain. And lacking the resources to defend itself against them, it subcontracted the necessary violence to sea captains willing to attack enemy shipping in return for being allowed to keep most of the profits from any captured cargo. Spain, together with Portugal, had set up a global empire which shipped considerable wealth back home, making it a prime target for such attacks. And it was this piratical activity that drew the first English ships into Asian maritime trade routes. There they discovered that the most lucrative trade was in spices, which could be traded at great profit even where there were no Spanish ships full of gold to attack. Though in fact, this way of subcontracting violence persisted for at least two centuries, as far as I can see. But in this particular business of trade, they tended to lose out in competition in the Spice Islands of Indonesia with another group of seafaring interlopers, the Dutch. In economic affairs, the English state had to offer its agents rewards other than plunder. You know, they can't simply support piracy indefinitely. And the predominant way of doing this without drawing on taxation was through the granting of monopolies, including monopolies on defined areas of overseas trade. In this way, an East India Company was organized as a private business, and it found that its best opportunities were in South Asia rather than Indonesia. The English move from piracy to trade was certainly not a smooth one. I note that Timothy Brooke, in his recent book, Great State, China and the World, now available in paperback, devotes a fascinating chapter to how an English merchant in Batam, Indonesia, in 1604, felt obliged to torture to death a Chinese goldsmith who'd been involved in trying to rob him, despite the Englishman's efforts at establishing himself and his newly arrived fellow countrymen as fair-minded traders, not just pirates. But the notion that the best way to make a profit was still through violence was, it didn't disappear immediately. It was very much to the forefront of British minds even later. But when the East India Company under Sir Josiah Child, who we're now talking about a man who lived 1630 to 1699, he decided that the best way to make a profit was to attack the Mughal Empire, which in the late 17th century covered much of the subcontinent of South Asia. But the English were completely defeated, and Sir Josiah was forced literally to kowtow and apologize to the Mughal emperor, who was generous enough to allow him to continue trading. Unfortunately for South Asia, however, the Mughal state, though prosperous and usually very tolerant, was not strongly centralized, and it fell apart in the 18th century. This gave opportunities not only to Indian rivals, Marathas and others, but also to outsiders, which included now not only the English, but also the French. Since France had, by the 18th century, once again become even more than Spain the main target of British hostility, expanding British influence in South Asia became both a business venture and also part of a global effort against the omnipresent French threat. Now, in this way, the East India Company moved during this period of the 18th century from being a trading organization to acting as the effective government of large parts of the South Asian region. And in order to administer this territory, some knowledge of local legal traditions became necessary. And rather than simply looking to the Islamic modes of jurisprudence that had prevailed in the Mughal Empire, the British found that they had to draw on the ancient Sanskrit language legal sources of their majority Hindu subjects. And the study of these materials was well underway by the end of the 18th century. The whole story of as to how this came about and what the consequences were is a complex one that fortunately has now been told elsewhere. I was particularly interested to read, for example, that at first the only language of law known to any Briton was Persian. So initially, the legal compendium put together for the British in Sanskrit by local experts had to be translated into Persian via an oral rendering in Bengali, with inevitably slightly mixed results. But as the 19th century unfolded, given the position of British authority in the subcontinent, the further question of how to educate their Indian subjects so that they could assist in the imperial enterprise also came to the fore. There was much to be said in the wake of the industrial and scientific development in Europe for introducing new knowledge using the English language as a vehicle. But the social norms rooted in Indian society were also recognized as the product of earlier Sanskrit culture, and in Sri Lanka as deriving from the norms enshrined in the related language of Pali, in much the same way that the heritage of Western civilization was seen as transmitted through the study of Latin and Greek. Now, however, some saw the gap between the learning that was there to be conveyed in the English language and that embodied in both Hindu and Muslim materials was so great that the languages of the latter traditions should be abandoned entirely. In 1835, quite notoriously, Thomas, later Lord Macaulay, declared that, and this is only one quotation from his rather trenchant views, "It is, I believe, no exaggeration to say that all the historical information which has been collected from all the books written in the Sanskrit language is less valuable than what may be found in the most paltry abridgments used at preparatory schools in England." But his view was fortunately strongly contested by better informed persons. Lancelot Wilkinson, who seems to have lived from about 1805 to 1841, for example, was impressed by the everyday achievements of Indian learning in such matters as predicting eclipses, and also felt, and this is a quotation from him, "The attempts to educate the mass of the people through the means of English must fail. Linguistic imperialism did not end in triumph entirely." Indeed, very fortunately, the encounter with Sanskrit as the language of Hindu law had entailed the realization that it was actually genetically related to Latin and Greek, together indeed with the Persian that had been the language of the Mughal rulers. So given that the British elite were educated in Latin and Greek, it became just one more step for some of them to go on to study the Indo-European languages of Asia with an eye to government in India. The Orientalism that has been pointed out forcefully in recent decades represents not simply appreciation of Asian culture, but also in some respects a desire to affirm superiority through appropriation. In part, that sense of superiority was bolstered by influences from the Protestant Christianity that had long been the hallmark of a British identity, embracing Wales and England and even Scotland, though only partially in the case of Ireland. Spreading Protestant Christianity became a motive for mastering all forms of Asian language, even those like Tamil, that were unrelated to Indo-European. But this sense of superiority was never unchallenged and eventually faded during the 20th century. In no small part because of the response of South Asian scholars to the experience of imperialism, which was, of course, but one facet of the greater struggle for independence. Though Buddhism has not over recent centuries been so much in evidence as part of the cultural heritage in the Indian subcontinent, apart from Nepal and Sri Lanka, a rich tradition of modern Buddhist studies has arisen there, including some scholars such as Prabodh Chandra Bagchi, who lived from 1898 to 1956, who embraced the study of Chinese materials in reconstructing the history of the Indian past. Thus, this involvement of Britain with the cultural traditions of India is the reason that a good number of British scholars may be found mentioned in the pages of de Jong's Little History. One or two of these names are certainly there because they developed an interest in Buddhism and so learned the requisite Indian languages, as tends to be the case today, as indeed other English speakers now learn those languages out of an interest in other Indian traditions, such as Hinduism. So for an example of someone who learned from a desire to learn more about the Buddhist tradition itself, one could mention Miss I.B. Horner, the great Pali scholar who lived from 1896 to 1981, very active in the Pali Text Society. But other scholars you have to see as being in de Jong's book, because their encounter with Buddhism stemmed from their philological interests, as de Jong's interests were. And it's a point that's worth stressing because that age that produced these figures is now passing into history with the death in November 2020 of K.R. Norman, whose dates are 1925 to 2020. And as is well known, he was, like Miss Horner, a scholar of Pali. His path into Buddhist studies was well described after his retirement from teaching in a book on the philological approach to Buddhism, articulating an outlook that had already become very uncommon by the year he published it in 1994. But the same philological background also held true for his Cambridge colleague, John Brough, 1917 to 1984, who unfortunately died before reaching retirement. But Brough's own posthumously selected papers make it clear enough when one looks at the whole scope of his broader linguistic perspective, which went far beyond the study of Buddhism itself. Though, of course, he made significant contributions to Buddhist studies. The approach is again philological. And in any case, I can vouch from personal knowledge of both men from when I was teaching at Cambridge that whatever their understanding of the Buddhist religion, or indeed of Jainism, which Roy Norman also researched from a philological point of view, or Hinduism, which John Brough also knew a lot about, they both affirmed a solely philological motive for reading Buddhist or other sources. And in one remarkable instance, occasional publications on Buddhist philological topics was just part of a completely omnivorous appetite for learning ancient tongues. It did lead to a professorship of Sanskrit, but almost incidentally, in the course of uncovering the further reaches of Indo-European and even beyond. I'm talking about Sir Harold Bailey, who lived from 1899 to 1966. In his obituary in the Bulletin of the School of Oriental and African Studies, you can read how he's said to have remarked once that once one has learned 30 or so languages, the principles become obvious, and it's only a matter of spending a few days with the vocabulary. So this is somebody whose erudition is absolutely staggering. But once again, it's a philological erudition. And there's something else that needs to be said, because in all fairness, I should also point out that these scholars who engaged imaginatively with the cultural riches of South Asia were truly exceptional men and women. And even at the height of empire, the United Kingdom had fewer than one-sixth of the professorships of Sanskrit that Germany had, while provision in British India was, if anything, yet worse. Despite the benefits that understanding the Indian heritage could have brought to British imperial rule, which were quite explicitly acknowledged. So here are topics which are categorized as being potentially in the service of empire, and yet not many people took them up. In Britain, when we think of relations between our country and South Asia, we think most readily of the great writers about the Raj, you know, men like Rudyard Kipling, 1865 to 1936, who defended imperialism, or even more, people who were more alert to its hypocrisies, like E.M. Forster, 1879 to 1970. Well, for all his undoubted faults, Kipling was well enough informed to take an interest in Buddhism and to make a Tibetan Lama a figure in his book, Kim. But this is misleading if one turns to writers who were very popular but less accomplished. I've dipped into a book, for example, by a best-selling writer called Ethel M. Dell, 1881 to 1939, and found in it that India is simply used as an exotic backdrop in which the only important protagonists are British. Nothing of Indian culture is ever mentioned, let alone found worthy of exploration. Despite the widespread admiration in Victorian Britain for the Roman Empire as a kind of template for what they thought they were doing, the British capacity for sympathy and certainly sympathetic interaction with the peoples they encountered, unless connected on occasion with the propagation of Christianity, was much more limited. Though, as has been suggested so far, Britain, like Rome, can be seen in some respects as conquering the world in self-defense, And we'll come on to the factor of imperial competition with others shortly. The motive of material gain is much more evident. As long as the money came in and there was no threat of interruption to its flow, the cultures whence the income derived were of no consequence. Where it was necessary to administer territory, this might change, but primarily only insofar as concerned understanding other societies was necessary to maintain law and order and continue making money uninterrupted. A few administrators did reflect on the nature of the societies for which they were responsible. A good example would be Sir Arthur C. Lyell, who lived from 1835 to 1911, who was intrigued enough by the Indian dominions for which he was responsible. He was right at the top of the administration. He was intrigued enough to compare them, his Indian dominions, with the China over which his Manchu contemporaries ruled. And this was actually well before Max Weber, who you'll recall was 1864 to 1920. Max Weber more famously interested himself in such matters, comparing Chinese society, Indian society. He wasn't the first, actually. But again, it should be stressed that Lyell was exceptional. Most administrators seem to have reflected very little on their situation. And as for the wider British public, writers like Kipling diffused a certain image of India, but the study of South Asia was not thereby encouraged. Now, if we turn to China, the general outline of British imperial aggression towards China will be widely known to the Chinese-speaking public. But so far in Britain, as with India, it's that history of aggression is much less known to the British public, who are still unaccustomed to considering the study of China as a regular part of British education. But comparison with the Indian case is even so instructive. The Manchu Empire was, unlike the Mughal Empire, from first to last, an effectively centralized state. Even before they conquered China, they were well organized along Chinese patterns for the most part. And the Manchu Empire was therefore never removed from power by external attack, but only in the end by the actions of its subjects in China by the Chinese, in Mongolia under Buddhist leadership by the Mongols, and so on. So when the East India Company and other such bodies came to trade, they were soon effectively confined to Canton. And so long as the trade remained advantageous to both sides, all went well. When matters started to go less well, I need hardly tell you, the first aspect of China that the British concerned themselves with was Chinese law in 1810. And after ascertaining what the laws of the Qing dynasty were, in the interest of profit, they then proceeded to break them and eventually to attack China. Though unlike India, the resistance was sufficient for the Manchus to lose only a relatively small amount of territory. So, administrative concerns were for the British not so urgent as in the Indian case, and reliance on local custom tended to prompt an interest in Buddhist matters only in quite a limited way. You won't find much about Buddhists institutions that comes out of Hong Kong colonial government. There is some good work by a late colleague of mine, Anthony Dix, but it's fairly limited. But the breakdown of trading relations with China that precipitated the sorry tale of conflict and British semi-colonial intrusion in China coincided with the appearance there of a new group of Britons who had not been, initially at least, of importance in the Indian situation, though their presence there did become relevant also to the Indian colonial dynamic. And these were the missionaries of Protestant Christianity. They were, of course, by no means the first European missionaries to reach Asia, not even the first Protestants in the case of India. I think the Danes sponsored missionaries long before any British missionaries were allowed in there. But British missionary enterprise followed a pattern quite different from that of the various Catholic orders that did so much to introduce Chinese civilization to Europe, going back to William of Rubruck and Odorinco. But the efforts of the Catholics, after all, were exerted as agents of a single centralized authority, meaning the papacy. And though when that papal authority could not be reconciled with that of the Manchu emperors, their work was curtailed, at least they had no family responsibilities and were well-funded, thanks to the piety of wealthy groups such as the French aristocracy. By contrast, the first Protestant missionary to China was underfunded and isolated, and his disparate group of backers had at first not wanted to evangelize China anyhow, because they suspected it might be easier to make converts elsewhere. So in the end, he was obliged to seek employment with the East India Company simply to support himself and his family. He had, you know, mouths to feed. But the consequence of this was that when the study of Sanskrit at length took hold in England because of the involvement with India, there were at least some Britons in China whom the first students of Buddhism in England could contact, other than the traders and soldiers who dominated the operations of the company and were totally uninterested in intellectual matters. First results, however, were not very promising. As well as the Pali texts of Sri Lanka, the British discovered in Nepal texts in Sanskrit, some of which were sent to France. In Paris, the French, who have a tendency to intellectual interests, had already established chairs of both Chinese and Sanskrit in 1814. And so they had become aware that a considerable Buddhist literature existed in Chinese translation. But it was not clear, even to the best of these scholars, which language this literature had been derived from. The British, when told about this by the French, seem to have opted for Pali, probably this Chinese material derives from Pali. I'm not sure why. I think it's just because they, you know, having taken possession of Sri Lanka, they thought, oh, it would be good if it turns out that there are Chinese connections here. But the answer came back when they said, they actually sent, it's the way imperialism works, they sent off to the governor of Hong Kong to ask if, so we're talking about after the ceding of Hong Kong, ask if there are any of these texts in Pali surviving in China. And the answer came back, the governor found an interpreter, a Pomeranian missionary, who's Chinese, spoken Chinese, probably pretty good, a rather controversial fellow called Karl Gutzlaff, 1803 to 1851. And he said, well, nothing in the Pali language could be found, but plenty in translation. And he supplied a list of 156 books, many of which, in his view, contained Pali. His annotations, however, show that he had very little understanding of what he was talking about. The Diamond Sutra, for example, which is the fifth title in his list, is confidently described as some tales about the disciples of the Buddha, mostly in Pali. But as the French translated more Chinese Buddhist works, especially about the Chinese Buddhist travelers in India, light began to dawn. Horace Heyman Wilson, who dates from 1786 to 1860, and who from 1832 was the first professor of Sanskrit at Oxford, drawing on some remarks of Xuanzang in a French translation, realized in 1854 that the Indian language that Xuanzang is describing could only be Sanskrit. So a second letter was sent to the current governor of Hong Kong, wasn't the same man, this time specifically asking after Sanskrit works that are being carried back to China from India. Because, you know, Xuanzang, it says he carried Sanskrit works back to India. From India, sorry. This time, the reply came from a more scholarly missionary, Joseph Edkins, 1823 to 1905. And this time, a more helpful reply, giving, when due allowance is made for misprints, a much more coherent series of bibliographical notes. And separately, even a few volumes of Buddhist texts, which arrived back at the Royal Asiatic Society in London in 1855. Edkins went on to explore what he could of Chinese Buddhism, and in 1880 published in London a full volume of observations that were reissued substantially unchanged in a popular edition in 1893. And his remarks are not without interest throughout, though for present purposes, it is his thoughts on Chinese Buddhist studies in Britain that are of the greatest value. And this is a quotation. "I began studying Chinese Buddhism more than 40 years ago. Dr. Eitel, the Reverend Samuel Beale, and Mr. Consul Waters followed me and have done well." So that's his view of the matter in 1893. It's not part of his, I think, of his original survey. So Ernst Johann Eitel, who's 1838 to 1908, was another German missionary employed by the British government. But his doctoral studies on Chinese Buddhism were carried out for his German university. He did publish to some extent in English, but his training was elsewhere. Samuel Beale, the next man mentioned, 1825 to 1889, and we'll come back to him next week for sure, was for many years a naval chaplain in East Asia. Though he eventually became Professor of Chinese at University College London. The first of his many translations of Chinese Buddhist materials on the travels of Fa Xian was heavily criticized by the consular scholar Herbert Giles, 1845 to 1935, who produced his own version of the travels. But Edkins remarks with some justice that neither of their publications was annotated to the same level as the work by French scholars on the same text. The French have been working on this source and others already for some time. Thomas Waters, the third name, 1840 to 1901, is mentioned by de Jong, but primarily because of a lengthy review of his posthumously published study of Xuanzang, which was written by the great French scholar Paul Pelliot, 1874 to 1945. And Pelliot knew what he was talking about, and he certainly does applaud Thomas Waters for his understanding of the Chinese sources, but he did fault his historical research. and especially his weak grasp of Chinese historical phonology. I mean, part of the problem they were grappling with was that they read the Tang sources in modern Mandarin pronunciation and didn't grasp that to see the relationship with Sanskrit, you had to disregard that and reconstruct how things would have been pronounced in Tang times. Well, that was a question for this century. They didn't really cope with it in the 19th century at all. One important translator of Chinese who's not mentioned as such by Joseph Edkins did turn also to Buddhist works, but only in the late 19th century. And he certainly deserves some mention. That's the very famous James Legge, 1815 to 1897. He's still best known as a translator of Confucian texts. And he also provided some Taoist works in translation for the famous series Sacred Books of the East, a development well studied by several scholars these days. Perhaps in translating in 1886, the same travel record already available in French, and at that point in two English translations by Beale and one by Giles of Farsien, with also a substantial review of them by Waters, perhaps when he turned to this text, he was, as he suggests, primarily trying to educate himself. But Norman J. Girardot, in discussing the development of Legge's progress from Presbyterian missionary in China to Oxford professor, notes a broader context of his slowly developing Buddhist interests against the background of similar trends amongst other missionaries. A background which might also account for his 1893 study of a later Buddhist Chinese work of apologetics. As the missionaries became more familiar with Chinese culture, they gained a greater awareness of its significance. His sketch does, however, Girardot's sketch does, however, make clear that Legge was in both cases looking at travel records and Chinese Buddhist polemics, indebted also, especially for the provision of superior textual resources, to an East Asian Buddhist who had become known to him in Oxford University, a man he knew as Bunyu Nanjiao, 1849 to 1929. So that's the form of the name that he went by in Oxford. Now, Chen Jidong, a good Chinese scholar working in Japan, has carried out extensive research on person known in his homeland as Nanjiao Bunyu. And he has shown that Europeans were not the only ones who were looking for lost Buddhist scriptures in Sanskrit in China. In that the Japanese too had realized by the late 19th century that they might find some Sanskrit there. And both Chinese and Japanese at the end of the century had become aware that Europeans had secured elsewhere in Asia copious Buddhist materials in Sanskrit that they didn't have in East Asia. So the connection between British Indology and imperialism was, as Chen Jidong shows, perfectly evident to these visitors from East Asia. His research in this matter is very useful. But though they were well aware that British scholarship was connected with imperialism, or European scholarship in general tended to be connected with imperialism, they still felt that they could get some advantages from studying it. But when it came to Chinese Buddhism, the Japanese had very little to learn, as opposed to Indology, where there was an advantage to studying in, say, in Oxford. Those few Britons who managed to secure university posts as professors of Chinese after their retirement from East Asia were translators rather than scholars of Buddhism. The men I've been mentioning, with possibly Waters, perhaps, was capable of somewhat more, since he had books on Sanskrit with him during his consular postings. But he never had the opportunity to teach anyone. And he was very much the exception in the profession of consular service, which in the Chinese case, more generally ended up in alcoholism, madness, or suicide. So no wonder then that those Chinese in the early 20th century who wished to study Indology went to Germany rather than the United Kingdom. And we can think of some examples probably. The works that the British produced have now been expertly surveyed by my learned colleague Max Dig of Cardiff University, who's well qualified in both Indology and Sinology to give a considered verdict on their impact. He does give the translators of the so-called pilgrim records some credit in inspiring archaeological workers under the British Raj, though it was again initially French scholarship that guided the first uncertain efforts of these men, who came usually from a military background, as it happens. He also notes that the exclusively Indological contexts that had prompted calls for the translations effectively divorced any understanding of these Chinese Buddhist texts from their original environment and did not even encourage further research in that direction. Well, in my view, this is all too evident. I agree with him completely when you know that's what you see when you start to look at these translations. And one example that intrigues me is Giles. Giles lived a long time in China, had a decent knowledge of Chinese, and he rejoiced in his ability to detect errors in the Chinese translations of others. And so he kept up his efforts in this direction with regard to the travel writings of Fa Xian, right from his first attempts at supplanting the work of Beale in an 1870s Shanghai newspaper, on to a revised version of his own translation published by Cambridge University Press in 1923. And this 1923 version was even republished from another press in London as late as 1956. Yet still, this republication contains an error of his he seems to maintain throughout, despite the fact that in fact it had been corrected by Beale and Legg. It's a minor point, but it's interesting. As an example of an error, because when Fa Xian is in Sri Lanka, he witnesses a parade based on representations of Jataka stories, including one based on the story of Shyama, whose name is transcribed in Chinese by a single character, Shan. It's a character that generally means a glance, a blink of the eye, but it can be used as a homophone for the word that means a flash of lightning. And Giles sees this character and he translates it Fa Hsien saw a representation of the Buddha as a flash of lightning. And this is still here in 1956. Well, surely if he'd known anything about Buddhism, he would have known that there is simply no record of any past life of the Buddha where he manifests himself as a flash of lightning, or as indeed any Jataka where he is a meteorological phenomenon. And indeed, any such manifestations as a flash of lightning or as a cloud or whatever wouldn't count as a Jataka at all. You know, there's more, the Buddha is an elephant, the Buddha is a whatever. So these translations are not without their interest, but as evidence of the level of the understanding of Buddhism in Victorian or even Georgian Britain, they're not very reassuring. Anyhow, to return to the contacts with Japanese Buddhists explored by Chen Jidong, the Anglo-Japanese Alliance of 1902 to 1923 did continue to bring Japanese students to Britain. And I think that's quite important for knowledge of the classical Chinese language. And they began to exert, in fact, a cultural influence, which coincided with influences, especially through the export of Japanese art. And, you know, because there are inscriptions in Chinese on Japanese objects, this did have some limited effect on British awareness of Chinese language Buddhism and the need to study it. From 1919 to 1923, the School of Oriental Studies even commanded the service of an American academic who had had a substantial Japanese Buddhist training, the extraordinary William Montgomery McGovern, who's 1897 to 1964. He had a long life and several careers, but his publications, while limited to reproducing what he had learned in Japan, show at least that he had been well taught there, his publications on Buddhism. But unfortunately, an unauthorized trip to Lhasa in disguise precipitated his enforced resignation. You know, he caused a diplomatic incident by going to Tibet incognito, and this was very embarrassing for SOAS. So they just felt it was best if he left, and he did. He then got into Central American archaeology, international politics, all kinds of other things instead. But Japanese connections may also be seen throughout the career of Arthur Whaley, 1889 to 1966, who also taught in a voluntary capacity at SOAS, as it became, you know, the A is for Africa, which wasn't originally included. But mainly as an aftermath to a career from 1913 to 1929 at the British Museum. He owed a lot to, I think, to Japanese contacts, and he famously translated Japanese literature. It should be observed at the outset that Whaley's attitude to Japanese imperialism was always negative. True, his first reaction to the rise of Japanese militarism was silence rather than explicit condemnation. But this may well have been because friendships with Japanese individuals constrained his public utterances, lest he cause them trouble with the authorities. You know, he was in touch with Japanese who he respected on a personal level. He didn't want to get them into trouble. By 1938, even so, he was active in the China Campaign Committee. It's interesting history there of popular support for the Chinese resistance to Japan. And he contributed to a book designed to raise funds to help China. So it's quite clear where his sympathies lay. At the same time, he was from the start attentive to Japanese scholarship, as is clear from the fact that he was ready to enlist Japanese authority to defend his translation work in a spat with Herbert Giles over his renderings of Chinese poetry in 1918. Giles didn't know any Japanese, quite aggressively ignorant of Japanese. Didn't think it was important because Japanese derived everything worthwhile in their culture from China. But Whaley did use Japanese editions of Tang poetry, which had useful commentary in. According to Walter Simon, 1893 to 1981, we'll come back to him. He wrote an obituary for Whaley. According to Walter Simon, Whaley had encountered Sanskrit as an undergraduate while studying classics at Cambridge. This was one of the developments of the involvement with India and the realization of the connections of Indo-European languages, that if you were studying Latin and Greek in Cambridge, you did have the option of studying the connections of Latin and Greek with other ancient languages, specifically, usually Sanskrit, but also maybe Avestan, others. And this remained on the books. I'm not sure if it's still there. I think maybe not, but it remained on the books for a very long time. Roy Norman, for example, took this option when he was an undergraduate, though he wasn't intending to study Pali. That was entirely accidental, as it happens. But anyhow, Whaley had got some Sanskrit in his early years, to be sure. In dealing with Sino-Japanese Buddhism, his reach sometimes may have exceeded his grasp. I've looked at some very early Whaley publications. They're not, everybody starts off reasonably ignorant. That goes for him. But even if he presented himself to the wider reading public simply as a translator, the man who translated Genji, he reviewed rather widely, including publications on Chinese Buddhism. And in the course of this, he showed himself very well acquainted with developments in the relevant scholarship. Certainly his reviews, even the longest, do not generally adduce much in the way of new evidence relating to Chinese Buddhism. But nonetheless, by the time that his working life at the British Museum drew to an end, he had a much surer sense of what was significant for the development of Buddhist studies than when he started. And he didn't fail to point out, what Japanese publications, for example, were really important. And though the bulk of his mature technical studies in journals, not the translation stuff, but the more closely argued journal articles, they tend to publish, tend to focus on early China. But one article published in 1932 does touch on Indological matters, and it's retained its importance to this day, I think. Chang Zhong, you will know it, and that is his study entitled "Did the Buddha Die of Eating Pork?" which appeared in the first volume of the Belgian series Mélange Chinois et Bouddhique. And it's a substantial study. But one notes that when he adds to a popular work, like he has a book called The Real Tripitaka about Xuanzang, he does add some minimum annotation on Buddhist topics. But it's usually Chinese translations of Buddhist works rather than Indian works in Sanskrit that he tends to quote. But he knew what he was talking about, clearly. The academic study of Chinese Buddhism in Britain did not quite remain solely the responsibility of one man. Between the departure of McGovern after the hoo-ha about Lhasa and the arrival of Stanley Weinstein. But beyond the work of Whaley, there is not that much to report. William Sutil, 1861 to 1935, continued the tradition of missionary scholarship well back from China and installed in an Oxford professorship. And he, amongst other activities, was engaged in co-compiling a dictionary of Chinese Buddhist terms. This is still readily available, and you may know it. Chinese Buddhist terms in English. It's an obvious volume to pick up. But it must be said that it's markedly inferior to its contemporary Japanese equivalents. And in fact, in his preface, Sutil makes it quite plain that his work was actually well underway before he became aware of the existence of any Japanese predecessor. So it's not quite at the same standard. But as well as Sutil, was also in London, Sir Reginald Fleming Johnson, 1874 to 1938, tutor to the last emperor, and in the film, played by Peter O'Toole. And he brought back from China to his London professorship a number of Chinese Buddhist periodicals reflecting his deep interest in Buddhist topics. They're still in the SOAS library and have been used by at least one student of mine interested in Chinese Buddhism of the 1920s. But he didn't really publish any research on the basis of his reading. He preferred to seclude himself in Scotland on an ice island and have picnics with a lady friend. So not much from him. Now, in her 1961 review of the existing translations of texts from the Chan tradition, Ruth Fuller Sasaki, 1892 to 1967, formidable American woman who studied Zen in Japan, in Kyoto, she does an overview of what had been translated by that date, by including some British authors. And so she lists one translation by Arthur Whaley, but also another of the same work by the British expatriate R.H. Blythe, 1898 to 1964. Spent a long time in East Asia, Blythe. And as a school teacher, as a college teacher, and my teacher, Stanley Weinstein, wondered what he was doing there, because I think he arrived in the 1930s or something and stayed his whole life there. A few years ago, a surveyor happened to need to look at the apartment that I was living in, and he noticed my books and said, "Oh, Buddhism, do you know about R.H. Blythe?" And I said, "Yes." Why was he living out in East Asia during the 1930s, 40s, 50s? And the surveyor said, "Oh, my family is related to him. The reason why he was there was because he was escaping an unfortunate marriage." So still good for Zen translation. Ruth Fuller Sasaki mentions three other texts by John Blofeld, who had a degree in Chinese from Cambridge, John Blofeld, 1913 to 1897. And interesting, she was at one time the mother-in-law of Alan Watts, 1915 to 1973, who was a very successful popularizer in America. but he didn't really contribute to academic studies of Buddhism. So that's, as it were, the Zen for the mass market. There are, there are some translators worth mentioning. But at the other end of the academic spectrum, the conjunction of two successive professors of Sanskrit capable of using Chinese sources with a professor of Chinese interested in philological issues did lead to substantial progress in understanding early Chinese Buddhist translations, and specifically this question I've already mentioned to you of understanding how Indian languages were reflected in Chinese translations once account had been taken of the translations of the Tang period and indeed earlier. And the late Seishi Karashima, another great loss to us, 1959 to 2019, in reviewing progress in this field quite early in his very distinguished and all too short career, remarks that it was the Cambridge trio, as he calls them, of the three men, or two men I've mentioned already, Sir Harold Bailey, who knew every language under the sun, and John Brough, who was a great Indologist, but also learned other languages to assist his Indological explorations. They were both in Cambridge, and the third man was Edwin G. Pulleyblank, 1922 to 2013, who was professor of Chinese. And he had a strong interest in the phonology of the, and indeed in the grammar, of the Chinese language in medieval times. So, they didn't exactly work together, but they were aware of each other and took cognizance of each other's research. And it was they, as a threesome, that in Karashima's view, brought into prominence the study of what Bailey christened Gandhari, which was the Middle Indo-Aryan language that underlay the Chinese text produced by the earliest translators. Even Edkins had looked at the earliest translations and said, well, these don't look like Sanskrit. The Tang ones, it's quite clear that the underlying, and even earlier, of course, that's clearly Sanskrit, but there are very early stage of translation. It looks a bit odd. And Edkins didn't have the means to pin down what was going on, but between Bailey Brough and Pulleyblank, they figured out that there's another language here. Bailey called it Gandhari, and Brough, outstandingly, published the first in-depth study of a text in Gandhari using a manuscript in that language in conjunction with his knowledge of Chinese and so forth. But I've not really, told you very much about the achievements of British studies of Chinese Buddhism, because there weren't many. But that's not quite the end of the story, since despite, Whaley was kept himself formally, once he managed to retire early, kept himself formally isolated from academic responsibilities. I mean, at one stage, the chair of Chinese at Cambridge fell vacant unexpectedly. And so he was clearly the best Chinese scholar in Britain. And so a tentative inquiry was made, to which he responded, "I would rather be dead." Whaley, even so, did teach. I asked my teacher, Michael Lowy, about this, and apparently in a small group, Whaley was positively inert, but one-to-one, he could be extremely helpful. And he did pass on some of his knowledge of Chinese Buddhism. And his assistance is indeed mentioned in a number of books. It appears from the preface to a groundbreaking work called Early Madhyamaka in India and China by Richard H. Robinson. Someone who left us all too soon as a result of a tragic accident, 1926 to 1970 his dates. So if you look in the preface of this masterwork, you will find that in fact Whaley did formally co-supervise his doctorate at SOAS. Whaley was, as it were, on the books as a volunteer. Together with the Dutch Indologist, an expert on Buddhist thought there, David Friedman, 1903 to 1984. Friedman was one of these scholars who was forced to flee the Nazis and very much to the benefit of SOAS because he stayed in London. Now, Robinson was a Canadian. He'd actually grown up in the region of Calgary in Alberta, which is where Pulleyblanc came from, actually. And though, as I've said, he died all too young, he did lay the foundations in his when he took up a teaching post in Madison, Wisconsin. He laid very solid foundations for the further development of Buddhist studies in North America. Through his training of a number of very influential students, Lewis Lancaster, Jeffrey Hopkins, Charles S. Prebisch. In other words, Lewis Lancaster is interested, for example, in Korean Buddhism, but Hopkins was a great leader in the establishment of Tibetan Buddhist studies and so forth. Robinson had acquired quite a broad knowledge in SOAS, and he used it to great effect to help set up linguistically broadly based Buddhist studies in North America. And Robinson's doctoral work is not the only British volume on Buddhism of the 1960s to acknowledge the joint guidance of Arthur Whaley and David Friedman. Richard S. Y. Chi, who dates from 1919 to 1986, slightly a man of mystery to me, though some of you may know who he was and what his background was, but he seems to have pursued several careers over several continents. I think he had qualifications in engineering, for example, but he ended up in Bloomington at Indiana University. But he had, it seems, doctoral degrees from both Oxford and Cambridge. An unusual distinction for any academic. There was a pioneer in the formidably difficult area of Buddhist formal logic. His research has inevitably been the subject of much revision, initially and not least from himself. So he's using SOAS teachers, Whaley and Friedman, but apparently securing, I don't know, from for the work on Buddhist logic, a degree from, I think, Cambridge. He also had Oxford connections. And of course, Chinese sources are but one of the range of materials upon which he drew. But as a native speaker of Chinese, I think he was from Northern Chinese, he was apparently pressed into service in the 1960s as a language teacher at Oxford, where his genial personality was expressed through his irrepressible amusement at the woeful attempts of British students at speaking his language. That's a reminiscence from a British student of Chinese of that period. So given the very slim productivity concerning the study of Chinese Buddhism in Britain before the arrival of Stanley Weinstein, and indeed the similarly slim record after his departure for Yale in 1968, he was actually replaced at SOAS by a SOAS Indological doctoral student, the Japanese scholar Inagaki Hisao, who I think is still with us, born 1929. But Inagaki only stayed in SOAS until 1981. And I think most of what he has published on Chinese Buddhism, but mainly after his return to Japan. So my attempted account of Chinese Buddhist studies in Britain, you know, only ends then with this rather mysterious Richard Cheese sojourn. And that's about it. So now what I'm going to do in the remaining time is turn briefly to the matter of Tibet. As I've made clear with regard to India, the English of the early modern period fixed their ambitions on becoming a naval power, pirates, or organized pirates. And one thing that may be said of Tibet without controversy is that it's a long way from the ocean. So we should not be surprised that any dawning awareness of Tibet in the United Kingdom came a long time after the first contacts of the Russians with the Tibetans, which may be seen as an inevitable consequence of the Russians advance into Asian lands, which were occupied by descendants of their erstwhile rulers, the Mongols. And as you know, the Mongols looked to Tibet for spiritual guidance throughout much of their history. Now, recent research into this narrative of Tibetological contacts by Russians as they move eastward traces this awareness of Tibetan back to the late 17th century, pretty early, and with library resources in Tibetan building up in Russia significantly in the next century. Now, it's true that thanks to an Armenian merchant, a copy of a 1688 Tibetan passport ended up in Oxford and was published there by an Orientalist, I think we'll call him, in 1700, but nobody seems to have paid any attention to that. So when, as a result of political changes in a small kingdom between Tibet and the East India Company's territory in Bengal, a missive arrived from the Panchen Lama at the British governor's residence in 1774, no one seems to have had much idea as to who he was. But since trading possibilities were evidently involved, readily exciting the governor's cupidity, more money, a diplomatic mission under an amiable Scot was sent back in response. But the fact that this man, George Bogle, 1746 to 1781, had to scrabble hard to find anything in Calcutta about the country he was asked to visit, beyond some less than detailed maps and other information gathered over half a century earlier by Jesuits in Manchu employment, that fact demonstrates how far behind British knowledge was. The map is kind of useless, and that's as good as he got. Nevertheless, it was a start. And the Buddhism of Tibet gradually began to be mentioned more in the English language, as I will have occasion to mention again in my next lecture. It's the image, at least, of Tibetan Buddhism does become fairly well known. I've also already mentioned in passing that the British interest in Nepal resulted in the acquisition, actually in 1837, of some Sanskrit Buddhist texts. And along with these, it seems, gained some Tibetan materials as well. But once again, it was French-speaking scholars, plus rather remarkably one lone Hungarian, who exploited the new materials, not British researchers. And the reason is obvious if you see the viewpoint that I've already described concerning the British in India. The British did not administer any Tibetan territories themselves. So it seems they regarded the beliefs of the inhabitants of that region as of no consequence at all. What they really wanted to know, I mean, they did want to know about Tibet. What they really wanted to know was how Tibet might be traversed by either friend or foe, because they're thinking now of their much better informed Russian imperial rivals, for instance. This is more a 19th century preoccupation as Russia develops as an imperial power. Oh, they're just over there beyond the mountains. What are they up to? Could they attack India? So they therefore dispatched agents from among their Indian subjects to survey the country in utmost secrecy. These are very well trained Indian surveyors. So they were measuring the mountains while ignoring the people. But eventually, such knowledge proved to be not merely academic. As the Russians grew closer. Eventually, heightened imperial competition, as is well known, prompted the British invasion of Tibet in 1903 at the initiative of Sir Francis Young Husband, 1863 to 1942. We may mention him next week too, an extraordinary individual who was certainly acting beyond his powers in some of the things he did in his invasion of Tibet. And the Young Husband took with him as chief of his military medical staff a man called L. Austin Waddell, 1854 to 1938, who'd learnt Tibetan in Darjeeling. He was a military doctor, but he had broad interests. And he was also, if you read accounts of Young Husband's invasion, considerably less bloodthirsty than his leader. And so it was he who encouraged Young Husband to secure by purchase, but apparently also by looting, a quantity of Tibetan Buddhist texts. And the importance of doing so was stressed to Waddell by Frederick William Thomas, F.W. Thomas, 1867 to 1956, who was librarian at the India Office Library in London. And he had been told by Russian visitors just how inferior British holdings of Tibetan materials were compared to those contained within Russian institutions. So this librarian in London knew exactly how the Russians were well ahead of the Brits when it came to knowing about Tibetan culture. Maybe the Brits were better informed about the height of mountains and stuff like that. Now, Waddell, the military doctor, returned from this expedition to a professorship of Tibetan in University College, London, from 1906 to 1908. So not long enough to really make much of an impact. But he was much acclaimed as an expert on Tibetan Buddhism, especially through his book on Tibetan Buddhism that had first appeared in 1895. And a revised edition of 1934 was show and tell. It was reprinted as late as 1967. And here I read from the flight. It is in 1967, a work that has never been superseded. But that's not entirely helpful that it wasn't superseded until 1967. There's a lot of very useful information in it. But the aspects of Tibetan Buddhism that had long reminded Europeans of Roman Catholic observances, in the case of Waddell, deeply affronted his Scottish Presbyterian soul, so that his presentation of what he called Lamaism is skewed in a distinctly Protestant and polemical direction. And this I'll have to explain a bit more in the next lecture. And furthermore, while, as I said, Waddell provides a lot of information about the outward observances that so offended him, he seems to have been very little interested in the inner life of Tibetan Buddhists. Fortunately, E.B. Cowell, 1826-1903, who was the professor of Sanskrit in Cambridge when the invasion of Tibet took place, he did encourage the study of Tibetan, even though coming at it very late in his career, he failed to learn the language himself. And indeed, even though he suspected pessimistically that it was just a bit too exotic for dull British tastes. But at least F.W. Thomas, the librarian and later a professor, was able to pursue a career using Tibetan as well as Sanskrit. And to some effect, de Jong mentions him in passing. But and it should be said that the outstanding scholars whom I've already mentioned from the mid-20th century, Brough and Bailey, also used Tibetan as well as Chinese for Indological research. And Bailey certainly had studied with F.W. Thomas. I simply do not know where Brough learned his Tibetan, but he certainly used it. And I think, however, it's fairly safe to say that no continuous tradition of Tibetan studies was established in the United Kingdom before the Second World War. But the inadequacy of Britain's linguistic response in that crisis became so obvious as a consequence of the conflict that in 1947, excuse me, Lawrence Roger Lumley, 11th Lord Scarborough, 1896-1969, a former governor of Bombay, was commissioned to produce a report on this scandalous situation of British ignorance. That resulted, amongst other things, in a lectureship at SOAS, solely in Tibetan. Now, the professor of Chinese, Walter Simon, whom I've mentioned already in connection with Arthur Whaley, had already learned Tibetan to a certain degree in Germany before fleeing Hitler. But again, for philological purposes. And a new post was filled in 1950 by David Snellgrove, 1920-2016, who has a very full autobiography, which you may read and learn all about Professor Snellgrove. And he started his studies of Asian languages at Cambridge in 1946, studying Sanskrit with Bailey. And he'd already had some contact with Tibetans during the war. He was in the military in India, as actually Roy Norman had been, for example. But Snellgrove makes it quite clear in his autobiography that his main Tibetological education took place from 1949 onwards, not in Britain, but in Italy with the great Giuseppe Tucci, the very famous scholar of Tibetan, 1894 to 1984. Snell Grove would just go to Italy every summer and stay at Tucci's place and increase his knowledge. And later, a second lectureship in Tibetan was created that went to a Japanese Buddhological student, John Brough, Yamada Ishii, 1933 to 2017, that he eventually left SOAS for Northwestern in the USA in 1971. But from 1964, Philip Denwood had also joined SOAS to work on things like Tibetan material culture. And he replaced Yamada. I think Inagaki, who I mentioned earlier, was also a student of Brough's and also a student in Indology rather than Chinese Buddhism, which I think explains Inagaki's initial reluctance to work on Chinese topics. But anyhow, both Inagaki, who's I think gained his PhD about the time that Stanley Weinstein left London, and Yamada both left in due course. But this did leave both David Snellgrove and Philip Denwood teaching Tibetan in London. Meanwhile, a post in Tibetan in Cambridge had come and gone. And from 1976, Michael Aris, who's probably best known as 1946-1999, best known as the late husband of Aung San Suu Kyi, Michael Aris started to promote Tibetan in Oxford, and it now is well established. And indeed, there's a lot more that undoubtedly needs to be said. You know, a full account of the study of Tibetan Buddhism in British academic life up to the present would certainly have to include, in Bristol, for example, Paul Williams, who's, I think, a year younger than I am. He is actually mentioned in de Jong's little book, along with Snellgrove. But in bringing these very sketchy remarks back to de Jong's much more magisterial overview with which I started, I think it's time to leave the British academic scene. And I stress academic, as it's in the title of my lecture, because you know, the remaining question is, of course, what else was taking place in Britain with regard to the study of Buddhism? And this is something which I do intend to address in my next and final lecture with a concluding account, which is based not like this one on a rather sketchy survey, but on the attention paid to a particular text. And I'm not going to treat it comprehensively, I'm afraid, but I am going to treat it once again within a broader historical context. My hope is that having given this repeated, actually, this quick overview in this week's lecture, I'll be able to take another approach next week, which will allow you to see things from a further perspective. Meanwhile, I've come to the end of what I'm going to say, and there is a little time left in which I would be happy. I see there are things in the chat box. Can this be of relevance already? Yes. Hi, Raymond. Yes, thank you. I'd be happy to respond to your observations. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Professor, for your inspiring lecture. So now the session is open to the floor, and I already see a question in the chat box, which is from Raymond. I think he's from Buddhist Dog Global. So, Professor, can you see the question in the chat box?
Yes. Well, I see Raymond's remark, and obviously Raymond is himself very well informed about the state of Buddhist studies. Yes, 19th century preoccupations were unavoidable. I think we have to say that hello, have I lost you? Ah, there you are. Yes. Sorry, my laptop is eccentric at the best of times. Another factor which I should mention in case it becomes relevant next week is that I'm always scared that the postman may interrupt what I'm saying. I tend to order books which arrive during the morning. Yes. I think as Raymond says, the 19th century preoccupations were unavoidable. It's an era where I think one has to be frank about the degree to which imperialism involved domination, violence, and so forth, especially because these are, insofar as regards Britain, factors that can easily be overlooked today, where the Britain is still engaged in violence, but not so much in domination. The culture that produced the scholars, as I've talked about, is becoming more remote from us. The military culture, certainly. To some extent, the religious culture too. I mean, Protestant Christianity still predominates in Britain, but perhaps the forms in which it was present in the 19th century are now unfamiliar to us. And especially, I must say, and we may well come back to this next week, the way in which Protestant Christianity amongst the English-speaking peoples saw itself as in competition with Roman Catholicism and tended to be extremely hostile to Roman Catholics. So this was not universal. Even in the early 19th century, you find that Roman Catholic missionaries and early British students of China could be quite civil to each other. Although, in fact, the most significant Roman Catholic to help the first British students of China was actually a Brazilian. And he seems to have taken a dim view of a lot of his European colleagues, and therefore, to have tended to help the British more than some of them might have done. But we'll get more of a perspective on that perhaps next week. Yes, thank you, Raymond.
Okay, thank you, Professor. Are there any more questions or feedback?
Hello, Professor.
Hi.
Yeah, in your lecture, you mentioned that the Nanjun Buyung, a Japanese yes. monk, studied in Oxford. And, this Yang Wenhui.
Yes.
In London and served in the Chinese embassy there. And of course, he has made Nanjo, it seems.
Yes.
Had a discussion. Do you know more about this?
Well, I obviously mentioned when I was talking about Japanese, I said Japanese became aware of the existence of Sanskrit materials through their that were hitherto unknown to them through Nanjo's visit to Oxford. But Yang Wenhui also, I said Chinese and Japanese because Yang Wenhui was also involved in this. There is, if you look at his correspondence, you know, he and Nanjo communicates in elegant Chinese. And one of the things that Nanjo is trying to do is explain the grammar of Sanskrit to Yang Wenhui in Chinese. You can see that wasn't easy. So I can't blame, I said, well, and then Chinese scholars then went off to Germany to learn Sanskrit properly. And you can probably think of some examples of Chinese scholars who went to Germany. But I think, you know, what it came down to was that, yes, Yang Wenhui, and remember, he was already not a young man when he became aware of Sanskrit. You know, Nanjo tried to explain the grammar of Sanskrit to him, and he probably thought, oh, this is a bit difficult. But of course, what I find fascinating is his schemes for Buddhist education and his curriculum. I suspect that, again, the Buddhist curriculum, to some extent, it will. He was, after all, a layman. I don't think, you know, he didn't spend time in a monastery at any stage. His curriculum, I wonder to what extent it is a curriculum based on the 19th century monastic curriculum in China, or to what extent, again, he's learning from someone like Nanjo, because Japanese Buddhist education too was being solidified and reformed in Japan in the late 19th century. I think these contacts are absolutely fascinating, and I'm very grateful to Professor Chen for giving me a copy of his first book on this area, which is extremely enlightening. Maybe we'll mention Yang Wenhui next time, because I'm going to be talking about the awakening of faith, but I'm not going to say that much, because my student, Professor Francesca Torocco, has already published in this area. Rather than do more work on Yang, I've preferred to use different sources in Britain to talk about another angle that hasn't been investigated so far. But thank you very much for mentioning Yang Wenhui.
Modern scholarship, you know, they think that because Yang Wenhui has exposed to, you know, Western education, therefore in his curriculum actually already reflected this. Therefore, he introduced the modern education system to China, particularly to Buddhists. So he is the first person in the lay Buddhist education in China.
And absolutely.
All his students promoted.
Yes, and very significant for the study of Chinese Buddhism in China in the 1920s and 30s. I see also Georgios has sent me a very interesting question, the sort of thing that all lecturers are liable to be asked. In which way do you see the past informing the present study of Buddhism in the UK? I find it difficult to talk about the study of Buddhism in the UK. You will know in some ways because you have been involved in more centres of Buddhist studies than I have in the UK yourself. That's a difficult one for me to answer, but I will answer in a purely personal way about the study of Chinese Buddhism that I was initiated in. Not in London, as I said, but in Yale, where I went to study with Stanley Weinstein. I talked about Robinson in North America, who deployed his SOAS learning in Wisconsin. Weinstein had a long teaching career at Yale, and what he was doing on reflection was something quite interesting. He'd been through a Japanese Buddhist university, what he was doing was he was adapting a Japanese Buddhist university education to American students. So what I got was a year or so of coursework at Yale was a quick overview of Chinese Buddhism using often Japanese texts and textbooks. I had to learn Japanese, a reading knowledge of Japanese extremely quickly, because he was well before the end of the first year, he was simply handing out Japanese books and saying, read this. So I and my colleagues, fellow students, the ones who went back to Komazawa in 2018, I would say that, yes, the past was present within us in the sense that we've inherited the kind of late 19th century in origin Japanese university system of Buddhist education. You know, I can look at what Yang Wenhui brought back and suggested for his educational enterprises, and I can see texts that Weinstein himself used on the basis of a knowledge of Japanese education that Weinstein was using in Yale. However, every Weinstein student thinks of themselves as somehow heretical, as having not successfully absorbed their teacher's extraordinary training, especially in Yogacara. And I certainly think I'm more heretical than most, because I'd actually been taught by a historian in Cambridge before I ever met Stanley Weinstein. So, in my case, I would say that am I really in Buddhist studies at all? I'm a historian who sort of wandered into the topic. Not the only one. I mean, Arthur Wright, who I also knew at Yale, but didn't study in close conjunction with, also, as it were, wandered into Buddhist studies from history. The past is certainly present, certainly in the Buddhist studies that I have experienced. It's not a solid tradition. It's been so weak, as I think my overview has suggested, and this may be an advantage, it's been so weak that it's been able to absorb a number of different influences. I mean, you'd have to ask somebody like Paul Williams about his experience, to get a fuller picture, maybe some of the others. I mean, the tradition of Pali studies, people like Lance Cousins and so forth, you can see that as, that may be a solid tradition, even if in the person of someone like Roy Norman, it was more philology than a Buddhist studies. That, for the reasons I think I made clear, has strong roots in the 19th century, but the kind of Buddhist, East Asian Buddhist studies, different story, I think. Does that help?
Thank you, Timothy. It's very nice to see you again. It's been many years.
It's been a while. I'm very glad to see you in Hong Kong. Yeah.
Yes, it's a very nice group here. It's a great place. Yes, thank you. No, I was just thinking in terms more of intellectual history, if you see some patterns that seem to be repeating, but with a difference, repetition with a difference. Not, of course, it's not the same as it was. And it cannot be the same, but if there were like some prevailing patterns in the academic tradition in the UK, where you see in this very interesting historical rundown that you did for us, if you see something that is emerging, perhaps in a different way, but you can trace the roots in terms of the intellectual history of this field. I don't know if I'm making myself very clear. It's a bit late.
I think we may have to talk about this after next week, because but by enlarging the focus from the strictly academic, and indeed when I say academic, of course, you have to remember that the first generation in the 19th century were not academically trained at all. They were missionaries, consular officials, in some cases, you know, in the case of Waddell, a medical doctor. These are people coming from nowhere. So one has to take a slightly broader perspective, but I think you'll find next week interesting. Put it that way. What you will find also is that I haven't really had time to organize my thoughts in this area. What I'm hoping is that what I have to say will at least suggest some possibilities of further exploration to you and to other people who are, you know, well informed about the British situation. Anyhow, I see Raymond has come back to me. So the British Museum. Raymond raises the question of connected with Buddhism and how that influenced developments. most notoriously, when material culture would include the Dunhua manuscripts, for example. How did that influence the perception of Buddhism? Well, one thing you have to realize is that nobody ever saw the Dunhuang manuscripts until just about this century. I can't remember when the initially, in fact, the appearance of the Dunhuang manuscripts, which was hidden away, only took place because of the enterprise of Sarah Allen, who is an early China expert, who was involved in taking photographs of the oracle bone collections in Britain, which would have included the British Library. And she said, well, why don't we photograph some Dunhuang documents as well, while we're about it? So this was simply a byproduct of a non-Buddhist enterprise. And then, of course, that got off the ground rather slowly, but eventually the notion of digitization emerged. And that actually, I can tell you, was because of somebody I used to commute with. I used to commute with an art historian, and he was telling me about how in his field a lot of the materials had been digitized. And I noticed also that Eric Zürcher, I can't remember when he visited Britain, or possibly it was when I was on a visit to Leiden, he mentioned that a lot of his teaching materials were based on digital sources that he'd acquired. And so it seemed to me worthwhile. I mentioned this, I didn't do anything about it personally, but I thought it worthwhile to raise the question of funding for digitization. And of course, that has proved quite successful in bringing the Dunhuang manuscripts to greater prominence. I'm trying to think, however, if there are any aspects of material culture that the British Museum, for example, would have made more evident and would have stimulated an interest in Buddhism. But unfortunately, my knowledge of material culture is very, very poor. And I'm afraid, Raymond, I'm not, it bears thinking about, but I can't come up with an instant answer on that one. Sorry. Apologies.
I've got a question related to Raymond's. I mean, what the impact did the experience of Europeans from Denmark, from Germany, and from Britain, from France, had on the general study of Buddhism, not just Chinese Buddhism, in Britain?
Okay. There was an international element, of course, to the study of Buddhism within Europe. For example, the Danes in Pali studies made a great deal of progress very early. And of course, that meant that there was a lot of interaction. You know, Roy Norman was always going off to Copenhagen to help edit the, Pali Dictionary and so forth. To what extent certainly in Britain there was an admiration for French scholarship, a French language scholarship in the field, and someone like Arthur Whaley would have been very well aware of that. I mean, I discovered that there is an unsigned review which D.T. Suzuki thought had been written in English by Hu Shi. And he thought, Chinese competition. What it was that Arthur Whaley had written a review of Suzuki's work in which he mentioned the Dunhuang manuscripts. I mean, he didn't know about them because he was working at the British Museum, you know, which included the British Library at that time. So specifically in that review, there is a mention of Pelliot's research in Dunhuang. So Whaley was obviously well aware of what was going on in France. It's probably a good thing that Suzuki thought it was Hu Shi, because made him paying much more attention to Dunhuang sources and things like that, but it was actually Whaley. Whaley would have been well aware of German and French scholarship, for example. Some of the people teaching in London, were originally from Germany, or from, as I said, with Friedman, from Holland. Yes, you're quite right. There is a pan-European dimension to this. Russian Buddhology, which is extremely important, was less influential simply because fewer people in Britain, at any rate, knew Russian. I mean, some did, I'm sure. I'm trying to think. Glenn Dudbridge, for example, knew Russian, but I think Russian influence is perhaps more limited. But you're absolutely right to draw attention to the pan-European context. So, in a sense, what I've been talking about is kind of peripheral to start with. Britain is not that important. What is interesting is that the 19th century figures I introduced were running to catch up with the French, but they were not particularly cosmopolitan in terms of interacting further with European scholars. 20th century is different. As I pointed out, David Snelgrove, but you know, spent every summer in Italy, you know, Italian scholarship, you know, was clearly vital to him in the person of Tucci, certainly. And obviously, more recently, you know, someone like Antonino Forte has played a major role in English language scholarship, more in America, I think, than in Britain, which remains a bit of a backwater from the point of view of Chinese Buddhist studies, apart from people I mentioned like Max Daeg and so forth. Yeah, so it's a good point. Thank you.
So thank you, Professor, and thank you to all of you for joining the discussion. And Professor will offer one more online lecture for the series next Friday on the 21st. The theme is the story of the awakening of faith across three continents. So please don't miss it, and we hope to see you all again in the coming lecture. Thank you for joining, and have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thank you, Professor.
Thank
you. I'll see you next week.
Thank you.
See you.
Thank you.
See you next week. Thank you. See you.
Bye.